We have all been Rickrolled. The following video is the property of YouTube's Really Graceful. A link to her channel is provided at the bottom of this video's description box. I'd like to bring you a video of my own, but unfortunately I am not so talented, and when attempting to explain such matters to people I involuntarily shout "the bastards" at either the beginning, middle or end of each paragraph. Yours truly, Sybil D.
Hey internet friends. Once upon a time there existed an empire so great, it extended all the way from the Atlantic Ocean to the Euphrates River. But the rulers of this empire were greedy, and their political structure corrupt. The sheer size of their territory, claimed through wars of conquest, proved difficult to govern, the borders challenging to secure, relying on slaves as soldiers, guards, and laborers. So the leadership implemented oppressive taxation, funneling more and more money into the military, letting the blood flow for their pagan gods. And when this decadent empire eventually buckled under the weight of its own greed, the elite fled, leaving behind their mighty legacy, reduced to only a mound of rubble and a few choice paragraphs in high school world history books. The American media, which is a proven and documented extension of the government, refuses to address the obvious parallels between the fall of the Roman Empire and America's current reality. The decline in moral values, resulting in incompetent and corrupt leadership, the overexertion of the military in foreign lands, excess spending, aggressive taxation, inflation, and the ever-widening gap between the rich and the poor. But why would the American government want to keep its citizens in the dark about its decline? Going through a great deal of effort and cranking out propaganda for every new medium and indoctrinating young minds with a lackluster education system. Certainly, if most Americans knew about the state of their nation, at least a small percentage of them would want to work together to find a solution. After all, we are a nation which largely descended from immigrants and revolutionists. People who rejected injustice and challenged tyranny. That's why today we're going to discuss what the media won't tell us about the United States of America. If there's one common thread that connects the empires of the past, it's the characteristics of their fall. Corrupted by power, perversion, and bloodlust, infecting the minds of the sovereign, destroying the empire from within. But instead of erupting into flames, the Eastern Roman Empire smoldered all the way until 1453 AD. Only 40 years before Christopher Columbus sailed to America. Colonization of the Americas is often exemplified by the story of the Pilgrims arriving at Plymouth in the early 1600s, with the first colony at Jamestown established to find gold and spice, followed by the Puritans, then slaves brought over against their will, and of course, an influx of newcomers seeking economic opportunity. The majority of that opportunity, which was thwarted post-American Civil War, leaving the American economy in the hands of a powerful few. In 1862, when the Civil War was still waging on, Sidney Morse, the brother of famous inventor Samuel Morse, wrote a piece exposing the war as a British plot to enslave America's entire free population to the moneylenders. American philosopher and writer Lysander Spooner reiterated Morse's claims in his book, No Treason, stating that the British aristocracy, which at its heart is the Rothschild banking family, orchestrated the Civil War to divide America in half. And it worked. Black people were slaves, white people were slaves. Our history on the Civil War is very misguided. The United States was bankrupt and vulnerable after the Civil War, and seeing an opportunity to make a dollar and lay a foundation for future plans, the Rothschilds and other European financiers made credit available to the American government in the aftermath of the Civil War as a means to 1. Fight President Lincoln's greenback after Lincoln was assassinated for wanting the people to control their own monetary system instead of the Rothschild bankers. And 2. Collect interest from those who desperately needed the money, which would be the United States government at the time. In 1910, there was a secret gathering at Jekyll Island, Georgia, which laid the foundation for the Federal Reserve System. The meeting took place right on top of the Canaanite blood altar on the island, which I know sounds totally crazy, but underneath the Vatican is a pagan altar as well, with pagan idols like Medusa. Though in the Vatican's case, these pagan idols are attributed to the Roman cult Mithras. But I digress. By 1913, the Federal Reserve Act was passed, handing over America's gold and silver reserves and ultimately the total control of America's economy to the Federal Reserve Bank. In other words, a private corporation established their private bank, acting as the central bank of the United States. But it isn't even a government institution, but a privately owned banking system, the existence of which is unconstitutional. The Federal Reserve controls the rise and the fall, or the boom and the bust, of these financial cycles. That's been the pattern of this unconstitutional system since its implementation. The Fed controls the dollar to flood the market and starve the economy, causing regular people to lose everything, sending families into generations of debt. We, as Americans, do not control our own currency, but a foreign system does. It's the new slavery. Well, it's really an old practice with a facelift, Babylon debt slavery.
The Federal Reserve is a hybrid organization. It's a partnership between the federal government and the private banks. When you look at it deeper than that, its essence is neither as a government agency or a private company. In reality, it is a cartel. So what's the purpose of the secrecy? It's because when you look at the list of these people who went, they were the representatives of the banks, J.P. Morgan, the Rockefellers. They represented Kuhn Loeb and Company, Warburgs in Germany and the Netherlands, and the Rothschilds in England. This was the money trust, not only of the United States, but of the world.
So why, if the Civil War was fought over slavery, are we still slaves? Do you own your car? Do you own your home? Have you paid off those student loans for that fancy college degree that you earned under the impression that it was a stepping stone to this elusive American dream that you have to be asleep for in order to experience? And consequently, the federal government went essentially bankrupt in the 1930s. While Social Security numbers started being assigned in 1936, tracking lifetime earnings in the number of years individuals have worked. During this time, the United States entered wars funded by bankers on both sides, the outcome of which was the destruction of the Ottoman Empire, the creation of the Zionist state of Israel, and the establishment of one global government. In our history books, we're told that Germany was the biggest loser of World War II, yet we're not really told the full reality. The Vatican supported Hitler, and boy oh boy, was Hitler a fan of ancient Rome. Former American Senator Prescott Bush funded the Nazis in the 1930s through the Union Bank, meaning that Americans gave rise to Hitler. If Germany really was the biggest loser of World War II, why did prominent Germans and Nazis become integrated into the American government with the space program and Operation Paperclip? Why does the CIA continue to utilize experiments and procedures that mirror that of Dr. Mengele's? Is Dr. Mengele the Dr. Green that numerous American MKUltra victims reference?
I'm Chris DiNicola, born July of 1962, rendering me 32 years of age. I was a subject in radiation as well as mind control and drug experiments performed by a man I knew as Dr. Green.
Arguments have surfaced defending Hitler's intentions pre-World War II, asserting that Hitler just wanted the best for the German people, for their economy. But Hitler knew of the Balfour Declaration of 1917, the document that promised Lord Rothschild a Zionist state in Palestine. So why did Hitler allow himself to be pushed into World War II by Great Britain? He knew what would happen. He knew exactly what the Rothschild bankers funding both sides of the war wanted. Doesn't this make Hitler the biggest Zionist ever by accident or by design? Since the end of World War II, the United States has only seen more war. The US military is in every foreign land imaginable, with young Americans being used as cannon fodder, like cattle for slaughter. Just like in ancient Rome, the United States sends the military to foreign lands, not to protect our own land, but to pursue these wars of conquest. The US allegedly fights wars for peace, but takes the spoils, like the oil. American currency once had strength because the global oil transactions were executed in the American dollar. But times are changing. China and its allies are ditching the petrodollar in favor of their own currency, which is convertible into gold. The industry once powered by the American dollar is now rivaled by a foreign currency, slowly stomping out the power that the dollar once held, which will impact regular old Americans the most. A dozen eggs cost 25 cents in 1971. Today, $1.68 is the price. But we don't get any more eggs. And on top of that, according to a 2017 report from Bankrate, nearly 6 in 10 Americans don't have enough savings to cover a $500 or a $1,000 unplanned expense. Yet the Fed continues to print as much money as they deem fit, its value created from thin air. All of our news, as well as our declining education system, is designed to keep us ignorant. ignorant from the fact that the Fed is a parasite on America. Our government is at the will of foreign lobbyists. The Vatican is a superpower. Hollywood is a circus. The breaking news headlines are a distraction. Most colleges are now daycares, expensive ones. And agendas are being implemented every day to divide us over race, religion, politics, and gender. Because the empire doesn't want us to know the truth. And the truth is, evil is a master of disguise. Crypto Jew, crypto Nazi, crypto Christian, crypto Muslim, whatever. Throughout history, the mask has changed, but the pattern has not. Will the masses ever awaken from their American dream? Or will history continue to repeat itself, time after time? And this is my opinion, but I want to make it clear that I believe as Americans, we have it really good by comparison. But in my lifetime, I've never known a moment when America was not at war. I grew up learning only the answers for standardized tests, with questions beyond, what kind of pencil can I use to fill out the Scantron, left unanswered by my teachers. Being told that college was the well-worn path to the American dream. But does the American dream still exist? Did it ever exist? What do you think, internet friends?
In the United States, copyright law allows for the fair use of copyrighted material under certain limited circumstances without the prior permission from the owner. Under the law, determinations of fair use take into account the purpose of the use, the nature of the copyrighted work, the amount and substantiality of the work used in relation to the work as a whole, and the effect of the use upon the potential market for the copyrighted work. Other jurisdictions may have similar copyright provisions protecting fair use or fair dealing. If you are uncertain as to whether a specific use qualifies as a fair use, you should consult a qualified copyright attorney.
You have the right to take it down.